usually I find that my views are about 30 degrees off from everyone else. And so there's something there to make everyone upset. Look, there's five freedoms in the First Amendment. Freedom of speech, freedom of press, freedom of association, freedom of religion, and the one everybody forgets, the petition for redress of grievances. Universities are not based on a system of freedom of speech. They're actually based on a system of freedom of association. And a safe space is a place where I and people like me can voluntarily associate in a group. And so that, to me, has to include fraternities, sororities, voluntary and, let me say, exclusive groups. I get to define the group the way that I want to, and your answer to that is not to demand that, let's say I'm in a Christian or Muslim group, you're an atheist. You can't demand to be part of that. It's a safe space. That association is a safe space. If you want to form an association, go ahead. So that's what freedom of association is. And to me, that's the essence of academic freedom. So if I want to have in a speaker, your answer is don't come. And if you want, you can protest outside. But you don't get to interrupt the speaker speaking to the people who want to hear her. So to me, the safe space is two parts. Everyone gets to define their own safe space within the university, so long as they're part of the university community. But no one gets to annex the entire university as their own safe space, where they can define what others get to hear, do, or say. That's just the definition of a university. So different departments have different approaches, that there are different academic disciplines. And if I were to go in, I'm an economist, if I were to go into the sociology department, say, you're doing this all wrong, and interrupt their speaker, that would be outrageous. Well, the same thing is true for other kinds of outside speakers. Now, one objection to, so I don't think it's that ideal. Where you might start to push me is to say, suppose that some group wants to have in a speaker from outside. What are the limits on what they can do? Is there anything that they could not do? And with the academic freedom, I would say, comes a kind of responsibility. People at universities have forgotten how privileged they are. It's a privilege to have this sort of setting where you get to define what you're going to think about and what you're going to say. You need to act in a way that is responsible to the people who are providing the funders, to the taxpayers, and to the constituents of the university, whether that be students or the citizens of the state, if it's a state university. So it comes with a responsibility. You can't just have in a speaker the purpose of which is to offend other people. You actually are obliged to say, this is something that I think is interesting and important, and I don't know how to enforce that. I do have a problem. I don't know how to enforce that. But so that's the ideal part, is under what circumstances does anyone get to say, like the Board of Trustees might get to say, no, we're not going to hire this professor with tenure, just as an example. So the limits of it are where I'm going to have trouble. But in terms of this being an ideal, I think it's just an everyday definition of the university. Everyone agrees with me until they realize that I also want to give this right to people they disagree with. And one of the difficulties that I have, is I tend to look for principles, whereas many of my colleagues in universities want to define rights pretty narrowly. That is, they have them and you don't. And they will be the judges of who will have what rights. I'm really skeptical of anyone doing that, and so I think the general principle is my right to have in any speaker I want is the same thing as your right to have in any speaker that you want. And if we disagree, don't come to the talk. You have no other recourse. You don't get to prevent speech. Now, there are difficulties like commencement speaker. Because a commencement speaker is really for the entire university. And suppose that some people really don't like the commencement speaker. Then maybe you're going to get some sorts of protest or maybe even try to shut them down. I have found that many people who first hear pretty much what you said, well, you're in favor of safe spaces. And I'll say, well, that's great that you're in favor of safe spaces. So you think there should be fraternities? Oh, no. Not fraternities. Well, that's part of there being a safe space. The right of freedom of association is pretty encompassing. One of the problems that universities have is viewpoint diversity, and there's two arguments that could be made in favor of viewpoint diversity. One is that it's a kind of right of oppressed people, in this case mostly conservatives, to have a position. That's pretty implausible. Conservatives with PhDs are going to have a hard time claiming that they're oppressed. The argument for viewpoint diversity is the educational benefit. And that is, and I've argued this a number of times, including almost exactly 7 years ago at Landfall at Wrightsville Beach, when I gave the speech on Freedman Day, people on the left, students on the left, should sue universities for non-performance of contract because they never learn how to argue without claiming victimhood and getting angry. Students on the right are well served in some ways by the existing system because they constantly have to think in logical terms. They have to be able to marshal evidence and logic. So I think the good thing is that there are a lot of serious academics on the left who firmly believe in viewpoint diversity in the sense that they would like for students to learn about positions other than their own from smart people. So this is not an ideological divide. This is a question about commitment to education. And there are actually a lot of unexpected allies on the left who favor having smart, interesting conservatives on campus. Now, maybe not a majority, but more than we have. So even people on the left will privately, usually not publicly, but will privately say, you know, we could actually use a little less groupthink. Because of the educational advantage. So I think conservatives make a mistake when they talk about it as a matter of rights. What we need to do is pitch it in terms of educational advantage of viewpoint diversity.